thank you. Friends, good morning and welcome to Asylum Hill Congregational Church, an open and affirming congregation in the United Church of Christ. We are honored and thrilled to connect with each one of you, whether you are watching us via the live stream, whether you are catching us later on in the week via our YouTube channel, and those of you who are here in our sanctuary, welcome. Welcome. It is good, as I said, to connect with each of you and to worship God together. I would ask that you please take a moment now or after the service to go to ahcc.org, and while you are there, please sign in as well as send us a prayer request. This helps us, your pastors, know what is on your heart and mind and what we can be praying for, not only today, but throughout the week as well. Also, please make sure that you are receiving, opening, and reading through our Friday emails. This is really the best way to get all of the information you need about upcoming events and programming directly following worship. We will engage in a time of fellowship together in Drew Hall. Each of you is invited. You can get to Drew Hall by either door to the left or right of the front of the sanctuary here. And during today's coffee hour and time of fellowship, we will be giving thanks for the ministry of Reverend Nina Schmidt. We will have an opportunity to give thanks for her a little bit later on in the service, but after worship, please come enjoy a cupcake or a pastry, a cup of coffee or some lemonade, and let us give thanks for Reverend Nina's ministry with us. I also, I wanna call forward Carol Pinkston to share with us an announcement regarding our first Spotlight on Summer event, which is coming up on Saturday, August 10th, when we will be going to see Hell's Kitchen on Broadway in New York City. Carol.
Good morning. Last year, my husband Frank and I took advantage of the church-sponsored bus trip down to New York City to see the Broadway musical Hadestown. And just wanted to let you all know what a fantastic, stress-free, easy way this is to enjoy not only a Broadway musical, but New York City itself. The bus drops you off and picks you up right in the theater district. And the day is structured such that there are just so many options. Some of us, when we first got there, chose to actually have a nice sit-down lunch before the musical. Others, like Erica and her family, took advantage of some really fun sightseeing opportunities. Then there's obviously the musical itself, I had not seen a Broadway musical before, so the chance to take advantage of that was incredible. And then after the performance, again, there were options. Some folks chose to sit and have a nice meal. Others of us chose at that point to just stretch our legs, walk around, do some incredible, you know, people watching. So it was just lots of fun. It's a day filled with opportunities, and it's stress-free and easy. And if you have the opportunity to take advantage of it, I would strongly recommend it. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. And all of that information is, again, on our website as well. So you can go and check that out there. Friends, students in Hartford and really all over our region will be headed back to school and to their classrooms on Tuesday, August 27th. And we have an opportunity as a congregation and as a community to positively impact children's educational experiences here in our neighborhood by providing children with tools they need to succeed. To that end, we are sponsoring a backpack drive beginning today, July 28th, and it will run through Sunday, August 11th. And we are asking folks to go ahead and purchase backpacks, no wheels, as those don't fit well in lockers, but to purchase backpacks for students, and you can drop those off here during the week in the church office, or again, any Sunday between now and the 11th of August. We are partnering with West Middle School, and so that is how we will begin to get those backpacks into into the hands and onto the backs of children in the Asylum Hill neighborhood. We are not asking, the school will be taking care of supplies, and so we are not asking for the backpacks to be filled with school supplies, but we are actually just asking for the backpacks themselves. I will say the school has an ambitious goal of 300 backpacks. They have 100 backpacks already given, and so we are looking to help them with the remainder of those 200 backpacks. So again, that information is also in the Friday email as well as on our website if you want to know how to do that. But again, helping children in our neighborhood and in our city be prepared for this upcoming year. Take a look around. Take a look around at the people you have the privilege of being with this morning. I know it's hot, but it is really good to be together. Take a deep breath, and as you are able, let us rise in body or in spirit and be called into worship today.
Break down the barriers that divide us, O Lord.
Tear down the walls of hostility and fear.
Melt the barbed wire of anger and hatred.
Breathe new life into your people, O God.
For we are called to newness in Christ Jesus.
We are all brothers and sisters through God's love.
Come, let us worship the God who removes obstacles from our path.
Let us praise God, who seeks to unite us in peace. Friends, indeed, Jesus is King. And now we share with one another the peace of Christ. May it be with you, and may you share it with each other. Friends, it is often said that the only thing that does not change is that there is always change. The only thing that does not change is that there is always change. And today we get to celebrate. We get to celebrate a change in ministry, and a change of plans, change in which God is making things forever new among us. For the last 6 months or so, we have had, maybe 7, 8 months, we have had the pleasure in this time of ministerial change for us at AHCC, we have had the pleasure of having two bridge ministers who have been with us, both working part-time to fulfill one full-time position. Reverend Sonia Green is with us, and we have also had the pleasure of having Reverend Nina Schmidt with us. I would love, Nina, if you would come up, please. That would be amazing. Coming into a position in transition is never a really easy thing. There's a lot of change. Sometimes there can be upheaval. There's a lot to learn very quickly. And I have just been so grateful for Nina, Reverend Nina's presence with us and your ministry with us. Reverend Nina has really worked very closely with a lot of our groups that are doing nurture and engagement. She has worked closely with our prayer groups. She has worked closely with our bereavement groups. She has been out in the community hosting monthly gatherings at Seabury, at Duncaster, at Macaulay. She does a monthly communion service, Protestant communion service. She has been doing one-on-one visits, among all sorts of other things. But really just getting to know the folks of Asylum Hill Congregational Church, and really just working on ways that she can and has best been able to be of service and nurture our faith journeys. And so, Nina, we are grateful. We are grateful for you and for the time you have spent. Most of you got Reverend Nina's letter a week and a half ago, and so this is, there's no ill will or reason for this. Just Reverend Nina is gonna take care of some of her own health and well-being and make sure that she can be there for God's people well into the future. Barbara, where are you? Barbara Matthews, where are you? Do I see you? Would you come up here?
Saw you earlier. You said, maybe I'll see you later, and she didn't know how soon that would be. Right, right. But in this unexpected and much too short stay with us, we want you to know how much you have meant to the members of the church, and I could tell that this morning by all those who were hugging you and greeting you. You've made quite a difference, and you made a big difference in my life. But I'm here today to represent the Hill Quilters. Oh, thank you. And for 20 years, this group has gotten together to make quilts, pillows for the church, chemotherapy hats, blankets, little squares that we give to baptism, the day of baptism. There are many other things that we have done. And most of the time, the gifts that we make are given to people we will never, ever meet. But this is being given to someone that we have met, someone that we've learned to respect and love. And when the weather gets a little cooler and you actually can use this quilt, We want you to know about the love that has gone into making it, and we want you to enjoy. And now I've forgotten what else it is you said. Okay. We hope also that this quilt will sustain you and help you to return to good health. May it be so.
All of those things are mutual. It's been such an unexpected joy to even be here and to get to know all of you and many who are not here, my colleagues, staff, etc. Really, truly, it's all good. I'm grateful to have known all of you. Our paths will cross from now and then. And quickly, the 13th century or 12th century poet Rumi, Sufi poet, wrote about accepting everything that comes to our doorstep with joy, because we never know what we're being prepared for next. So I've subscribed to that in God's plan, and I can't tell you how much I've been enriched by everything here, all things Asylum Hill Congregational Church, and I especially thank Erica for her wonderful support collegially, and everyone here, and my other colleagues, Sonia and Jordan. So, blessings to all of you. We'll go forward with hope in God. Amen.
So, today, our musical is Evita. Those of you who have been following our summer series, you know that it is the gospel according to Broadway, and each week we are featuring another Broadway musical and bringing to light some of the themes and the messages of love and of Christianity. That we can find in all sorts of places and in all sorts of different ways. Well, Evita is a musical by Andrew Lloyd Webber with lyrics by Tim Rice. It concentrates on the life of Argentine political leader Eva Perón, the second wife of Argentine President Juan Perón. The story follows Evita's early life, her rise to power, charity work, and her death. The musical began as a rock opera concept album released in 1976. Its success led to productions in London's West End in 1978, winning the Laurence Olivier Award for Best Musical, and on Broadway a year later, where it was the first British musical to receive the Tony Award for Best Musical. This has been followed by a string of professional tours and worldwide productions and numerous cast albums, as well as a 1996 film adaptation where Madonna played Evita. The musical was revived in London in 2006 and on Broadway in 2012, and toured the UK again in 2013 and 14 before running for 55 West End performances at the Dominion Theatre in September and October of 2014. It's interesting because in the late 1970s, the musical was panned by Argentina because of its representation of the caricature of their once beloved leader and his wife. The Evita storyline has been drawn from a biography based on stories from Eva's, shall we say, detractors. The biography in which this musical was based really is from the way that her enemies, per se, really saw her. And the way that she is depicted by those who don't like her is really by as a gold digger who slept her way to the top. And so Evita in Argentina was not well received. But today we're going to take a new look at it with some different eyes, friends. As we move into a time of prayer, there is so much to celebrate as a community of faith. So much to celebrate, and so much we lift to God for prayers, for comfort, and as an ask for God to be present. We celebrate with the birth of Jack Nielsen's new baby, Holly DeYoung. I thought maybe she was here. Holly DeYoung is a grandmother, and so we are celebrating with her. We also remember Beth Fossler in our prayers for continued healing and strength. We remember all of those among us who are in need of God's healing, God's presence, God's strength among us each and every day. Friends, we are also reminded that that prayer is really just a conversation with God, in which we have the privilege and the honor of lifting to God all that we are, all that we carry, and taking a moment of pause, a moment of quiet, a moment of stillness, to listen to how it is God calls back, speaks back, talks back to us. So let us pause for just a moment and let us be in the spirit of prayer together.
God, we believe you have called us to unity, but often we have isolated ourselves from others. Forgive us for the times we have turned our backs on those who are different. God, we believe you have called us to live together as one body, one strength. Forgive us for the times we have created division within your worldwide church. God, we believe you ask us to look, listen, and learn from others. Forgive us for the times we have ridiculed and attacked those who are different and have different viewpoints. God, we believe you ask us to accept and seek to understand all who are called by your name. Forgive us for the times we have offended you by failing to love others as much as you have commanded that we love ourselves. God, we believe you call us to be one, even as you are one. Forgive us for the disunity we have harbored and make us one. God and creator of all humankind, your son Jesus Christ prayed that your church might be one, even as you, our God, are one. May you renew our minds and rekindle our love in our hearts, so that by the power of the Spirit, we might find the oneness that you have intended for us. God, may we see in your oneness our need for unity. God, may we see in your threeness our need for community. God, may we see in your creativity our need for diversity. God, may we see in yourself our need to love each other. And now let us raise our voices as one praying together the prayer that Jesus Christ taught by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, we come to the time in our service where we get to respond, where we get to give back, where we get to share with one another and with the world just a small portion of the abundance that God has so beautifully and gracefully given to us. So even as our offering is now given and received, we will receive a beautiful gift of music.
I don't really think I need a reason why I won't succeed. I haven't started. Let's get this show on the road. Let's make it obvious. Perron is off and rolling.
Eyes, hair, mouth, figure, dress, voice, style, movement, hands, magic, rings, glamour, face, diamonds, excitement.
I came from the people. They need to adore me. So Christian Dior me. From my head to my toes, I need to be dazzling. I want to be Ray Bye. They need some excitement, and so I.
Hair, figure, dress, voice, style.
I'm their product. These of you sell me. Oh, Machiavelli, me. Make an Argentine rose. I need to be thrilling. I want to be Ray. Escape, and so do I.
Hair, mouth, figure, dress, voice, style, movement, hands, magic, rings, glamour, face, diamonds, excitement.
All my descamisitos expect me to outshine the enemy. The aristocracy, I won't disappoint them. I'm their savior, that's what they call me. So Lauren, but call me. Fantastic. I have to be rainbow and magical colors. You're not decorating a girl for a night on the town. And I'm not a secondary queen escaped from the crown. Next up will be Europe. The rainbow's gonna go dressed up somewhere to go. Well, put on a show. Just a little touch of Argentina, brand of star quality.
Loving God, we ask that you would accept the gifts that we give today, gifts from our hearts, gifts of our very lives, and use these gifts. Use them for the building up of your kingdom right here among us, around us, and in your world. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. We are going to go straight into our scripture today, which comes to us from Paul's first letter to Timothy. And Timothy is actually in Ephesus, and so that is where Paul is sending this letter to, is to Timothy in Ephesus. And this is what Paul has to say to Timothy. I desire then that in every place the men should pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. Also that the women should dress themselves modestly and decently in suitable clothing, not with their hair braided or with gold or pearls or expensive clothes, but with good works, as is proper for women who profess reverence for God. Let a woman learn in silence, with full submission. I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She is to keep silent. She is to keep silent, for Adam was formed first, and then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, sometimes we are so confused. Confused as to what we understand to be your word. Confused as to how we are supposed to take this word and use it for our very lives today. So help us. Help us. Help us. Amen. That's a doozy, right? So when I first arrived in Guayaquil, Ecuador, in the fall of 1997, I was 21 years old, a bright-eyed young woman who was ready to take on the injustices of the world as a Peace Corps volunteer. And when I look back on that version of myself, I am still amazed by her strength, her tenacity, and her optimism. And I'm also very aware that there was a good bit of naivete and a fairly decent measure of arrogance. I mean, I didn't really speak Spanish at the time, so how I, a white woman from the United States, thought I was going to waltz into a foreign country I knew nothing about and take a wrecking ball to national wrongs now seems absolutely absurd and laughable. And yet there I was. And I remember my host organization, Mi Cometa, organized one of my first community events. They had called together a group of women in the barrio to welcome me to Guasmo Sur. They told me it was a chance for me to share the vision I had for my work in the community over the next 2 years. Well, when I walked into the room where the women were assembled, we all just stared at each other for what seemed like a really long time. Until finally, one woman courageously blurted out, "Chiquita blanquita bonita, ¿por qué estás aquí?" Cute little white girl, why are you here? It felt like, to be honest, the Ecuadorian version of what Southerners say is, bless your heart. Chiquita blanquita, bonita, ¿por qué estás aquí? Well, I have to say, that was my first introduction to the Spanish diminutive suffix ita and ito, which is not only indicates a small size, but in some cases can add a nuance of affection or soften, as I think this was the case, the meaning of the actual word or words one is saying. So ita is I-T-A, and ito is I-T-O. Pejoratively, the suffix can be used condescendingly to put someone in their place, when, as my grandma would say, they've gotten a little too big for their britches. But the suffix is, as a sign of affection, is also real. As in mamita, hijita, hermanita, mom, daughter, sister, but with an emphasis on warmth and fondness, signaling a closeness of relationship, not being condescending. In the case of that day back in 1997, I'm pretty sure the itas attached to all the descriptor words for me were meant to let me know my place in that community, and it wasn't as a white savior. Now, I will say every woman in that room and I ended up having a close and loving relationships that are still cherished even today, some 30 years later. But that happened because of hard work, consistency, respect, and trust. In the beginning, it was simply chiquita, blanquita, bonita, ¿por qué estás aquí? If you've ever seen Andrew Lloyd Webber's Webber's operetta Evita, then you know at least a little something about the life of Eva Perón, one of Argentina's most beloved and controversial controversial political figures. While she was never an elected official, Evita had a profound and lasting impact on the social and political landscape of Argentina. Born in 1919, Maria Eva Durante grew up with her parents and four siblings. Evita's father, Juan Durante, was the Deputy Justice of Peace, and the family enjoyed a great deal of prominence and prosperity. However, pretty soon after Eva's birth, the leftist Radical Party won the president, and it is really the Radical Party. That's not a descriptor. It's actually called the Radical Party. Won the presidency, and conservative ideologies became incredibly unpopular. Well, this was bad news for Eva's father, Juan, who was solidly affiliated with the conservatives. Ultimately, this political change plunged the Durante family into extreme poverty. Evita was only 7 years old when her father died in a car accident in 1926. And in 1930, Evita's mother, Juana, moved her family to the town of Junin, where Evita got a taste of what would be her first career, acting. She loved the stage. She found that she absolutely loved being on stage. And as soon as she was deemed old enough, she moved to Argentina's capital of Buenos Aires, where she made her way as best she could without any real financial stability. Well, in 1994, Evita met Juan Perón, who was the Secretary of War and Labor, and the two were married just a year later in 1945. And soon after their marriage, Juan Perón was elected president of Argentina. The Peróns were both popular among the poor and working classes and unions, and the particular set of policies and beliefs held by Juan Perón eventually became a political party and political philosophy known as Peronism. And while it was popular among lower socioeconomic classes, in Argentina. Argentina didn't necessarily have too many sympathetic friends abroad, particularly in Europe. This would have been, when we think about it, this would have been at the end of World War II in the mid-1940s. So as First Lady, Evita was tasked with going and meeting foreign leaders in Europe. And in 1947, an invitation by the President of Spain led Evita on a trip known as the Rainbow Tour, which was the song that we just heard about during our offertory, Rainbow High. On this tour, Evita met with leaders in Italy, Portugal, France, Switzerland, and Monaco, as well as Argentinian South American neighbors, Brazil and Uruguay. Evita used these special visits to promote her husband's agenda abroad. She was also accompanied by a huge entourage and traveled in style. It is widely known that indeed Evita did have a fondness for expensive and world-class clothing, jewelry, and decor. So while Evita was immensely popular, there were others who considered her to be a hypocritical figure. How could a woman who publicly supported the interests of the poor and working classes allow herself to live such a luxe lifestyle? Despite the criticism lodged against her, Evita is credited with many, many wonderful accomplishments. She was instrumental in passing a law that gave women the right to vote in Argentina in 1947. In 1948, she established the Maria Eva Duarte de Perón Foundation, which served poor children and elderly people. And she is perhaps best known for championing the rights of the descamisados, meaning the shirtless ones, referring to the working labor class laborers, supporting legislation that improved working conditions and wages for some of the nation's poorest workers. And she did all of this in only 33 years. As she died of cancer in 1952. However, her legacy is every bit as active in Argentina today as it was when she and President Perón first rose to prominence. But friends, here's the underbelly of this story. Though very, very powerful and very popular, Eva Perón was subject to unbelievable, nasty sexism. Many who did not care for her bashed her for supposedly being a manipulative harlot who was secretly pulling all the country's political strings. And the jokes and the disinformation and the flat-out lies that were told and retold about her were unfair, out of line, and to this day continue to highlight the misogynistic nature of our world. For some, the Ita was used as a way of conveying their love and appreciation for the woman who worked hard for them, Evita, Evita. But for others, the Ita was used as a way of trying to diminish her, a way of putting her in her place, of making sure she knew just where she stood in the patriarchy. Evita, Evita. Chapter 2 of Paul's epistle to Timothy is part of a canon of biblical works that have become known to many women as the texts of terror. This phrase was coined in 1984 by Phyllis Tribble in her book, Texts of Terror, where she reflects on four Old Testament stories, the concubine in Judges, Tamar, Jephthah's daughter, and Hagar. Each of these stories describes violence against women without overt condemnation by either God or the narrators. And to be sure, none of these particular stories are preached about in worship services on Sunday mornings in America or in any nation in the world. And over the last 40 years, many other biblical stories, scripture passages, gospel readings, letters, psalms that propagate negative and dangerous stereotypes about women have been added to Tribble's list. Because if we're honest, friends, patriarchy is a tale as old as time. I mean, let's go back to our original, our origin story in Genesis. Even though God says, in my own image, I created them, both man and woman, I created in my own image. Throughout history, in the Judeo-Christian tradition, we tend not to focus on God's words, rather on God's deeds as recorded by men. One story says that Adam was opened up and a rib was taken from him, and from that rib, Eve was formed. Woman literally formed from man. Or the second story, it says man was created first, but he was lonely. So God created a helpmate for man because it was not good for man to be alone. In this second origin story, woman is created for the sole purpose of supporting man. And then you add to this the narrative of Eve being the one who was seduced into eating from the tree of knowledge and then coerced Adam into taking a fatal bite of the apple. So yes, for millennia, we have bought into and brought forward this idea that men were created first and therefore somehow closer to the heart of God, and that women are dangerous and should not be trusted, that they need to be simply subdued and brought under the control of the better of the two sexes. Which is no wonder why Jesus' relationships with women were met with such consternation. The woman at the well, Mary Magdalene, Mary and Martha, the women he heals and teaches and brings along with him. Folks, Jesus revolutionized a woman's place in the world and made sure that we know we are just as close to the heart of God as men. So what I want to say to you today as your spiritual leader is, friends, we cannot believe that God spoke to human beings for millennia, that God decided to break into human existence through the incarnation of Jesus, yet that we closed the canon on God's activities, and God was done. This is honestly a lie. Because God hasn't stopped, we know that. God hasn't stopped talking and teaching and healing and working and crying and laughing. Rather, God, through the Holy Spirit, continues even today to shape and mold humanity towards good. And here we are in 2024, and we can see some of that evolution, can't we? I mean, here in the United States, the 19th Amendment gave women the right to vote. It was ratified in 1920. 45 years later, the passage of the Voting Rights Act, in which all people of color, men and women, were afforded that right. That is part of an evolution towards justice, towards tipping those scales. I mean, you, many of you know this. This isn't history, this is your reality, your history. But did you know that women could not, in the United States, open a bank account, apply for a credit card, or a loan on their own without a male cosigner until 1974? That was the year before I was born. But we've done some evolving. There has been some writing of wrongs. There have been various movements, the feminist movement, the womanist movement, and more recently the Me Too movement, which have all tried to bring about gender equality in our legal and social structures. Close to home, right here at AHCC. Did you know that we elected our first female deacon in the 1980s? And its first female moderator of color in 2018. Some of you are watching the Olympics, I'm sure. Did you know that in 1900, when the first Olympic Games were held, there were only 22 female athletes? That was 2% of everyone who participated that year. This year, for the first time in history, Olympic and Paralympic Games will see an equal number of men and women competing. This 50-50 representation of athletes makes the Summer Games the first in their history to reach gender equality. So progress is being made slowly but surely. And yet, friends, there are also places where we seem to continue to need that extra push. Places where, as the people of God, we seem to need God to make it clear. Did you know that less than 10% of all pulpits in America are filled by female clergy? Our denomination, the UCC, is doing a little bit better. We are up around 22%. But the Church Universal has quite a way to go before we reach gender equality. And just this week, I have to tell you, I was so dismayed to hear a man running for political office callously refer to single childless women as being angry and an existential problem for family values in the United States of America. I mean, friends, I don't care. I don't care what side of the aisle you sit on. We have got to do better. We've got to do better by our ancestors. We've got to do better by those right here, right now. Because how we treat one another, what we say about one another, informs how our sons and daughters, how our nieces and nephews, how our grandchildren and great-grandchildren, how the generations to come will see one another. How they will treat one another. It didn't begin and end with a story like Evita's. It's been happening since the beginning of our origin stories with Eve in the garden. Eva is another word for Eve in Spanish. Or translated, it means Eve. Beloveds, we must stop demonizing one another based on our gender, identity, race, ethnicity, orientation, or any of the other ways we use to divide ourselves from one another. And might we instead lift one another up as beautiful individuals who are unique and different and who all have the imprint of the divine spirit upon our very beings. God reminds us that we were created in God's very own image, that God created us, both man and woman. We were created in God's image. May it be so. Amen.
It won't be easy, you'll think it's strange when I try to explain how I feel, that I still need your love after all that I've done. You won't believe me, all you will see is a girl that you knew just up to the nines, had sixes and sevens with you. I had to let it happen. I had to change. Couldn't stay all my life down at heel, looking out of the window, staying out of the sun. So I chose freedom, running around trying me at all. I never expected it to. Don't cry for me, Argentina. The truth is I never left you. All of my wild days, my existence, I kept my promise. Don't keep your distance. And as for fortune and as for fame, I never invited them in. Though it seemed to the world that was all I desired. They are illusions. They are not the solution to be. The answer was here all the time. I love you and hope you love me. Don't cry for me, Argentina. Too much. There's nothing more I can think of to say to you. But for all I have to do is look at me to know that every word is true.
let us receive now the benediction. Stories are powerful. They show us truth and reveal the meaning of our world. Stories are sacred. They reveal
how God is moving
in our midst. We are changed by their telling and their hearing. Stories are one of the ways Jesus taught because he knew how they touched and inspired. May we go out into the world today knowing that our stories are meant to be used to show the world more about God. We are bringing about the kingdom of God every time we share and listen. May it be so.
Amen.